Welcome to Season 3 of Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Josh Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement and a former Secretary of Maryland's Health Department. Our goal is to bring scientific evidence and experience to the public health news of the day through informative interviews with scientists, community leaders, policy experts, public health officials, clinicians, and more. If you have ideas or questions for us to cover, please email us at publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. Today, I speak to Professor Andy Pekosz of the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health about the UK variant of the SARS-CoV-2 virus. We talk about what this variant is, why it may be more contagious, and what each of us can do. Let's listen. Dr. Pekosz, thank you so much for talking to me about the new variant that has captured the world's attention with respect to COVID-19. Could we just start with you explaining what this variant is?
Yeah, so the this particular variant was detected in England, and it initially was a very interesting virus because it contains about 14 changes in its genome, and that is an incredibly high number compared to other strains, or other lineages of SARS-CoV-2 that are circulating right now. This virus mutates at a relatively slow rate, so seeing so many mutations in one virus was a real sort of bellwether to say, okay, something's going on here, we need to pay more attention to this. As the public health authorities in England started to sequence more viruses, they realized that this variant was actually becoming one of the dominant lineages of the virus in England, meaning that it was spreading faster than versions of the virus that had been in England for many weeks previously. And that suggested that this virus was being able to spread from person to person more easily than other lineages of SARS-CoV-2.
Got it. Before we delve into the nanoscale, I guess, to really understand what's going on inside the virus itself, talk for a second about the fact that the virus is constantly mutating. So how do we get from, you know, the usual SARS-CoV-2 virus to a variant with 14 mutations?
Yeah, so all viruses, but in particular, viruses that have RNA as their genome, like SARS-CoV-2, they all mutate at a particular rate. And since SARS-CoV-2 has been in the human population, there's been a detection of a couple of mutations every week or two in the virus. It's a very standard thing with viruses. They're, when they replicate, they make errors, and those errors are shown as mutations as the virus goes forward.
And sometimes those mutations wind up making the virus non-functional. The virus can't really do anything after that. Is that right?
Exactly. So these mutations, we often put them into three bins. The ones that that are negative or that hurt virus replication. And we rarely see those because those viruses die out very, very quickly. There are mutations that make the virus better at replicating, and those occur very, very rarely. But the vast majority of mutations are ones that fall in the middle. They're what we call neutral mutations. They occur, they don't seem to change the virus's ability to do anything, but they remain as a signature that the virus has been circulating and mutating. And if you follow those mutations over time, you can trace viruses in terms of where they've been, how long they've been circulating in humans, and it's sort of like a fingerprint of what the virus has been doing.
So that's how they know, for example, that people who went to this scientific conference in Boston, this industry conference, wound up spreading the virus all over the country and maybe even to many different countries.
Absolutely, because in that example, the people at the conference went back to their homes. When they sequenced those viruses, they were identical. But then as that virus moved into the population in various places, it would accumulate one mutation or two mutations. So now you know that this virus probably came from this person, picked up another mutation as it was spreading, and that's how you track these spreading chains of the virus.
And so you're looking at multiple mutations in this UK variant, and they're all concentrated in one particular area. Is that fair to say?
Well, the mutations are spread out along the entire genome. But when you look at a subset of the mutations, three of them appear in the spike protein. And that's important because the spike protein is the protein that the virus uses to attach to cells and get into cells. But it's also important because the spike protein is the antigen that we use in our vaccines that generate the antibodies that protect us from SARS-CoV-2 infection. And any mutation in spike is always a concern because it may alter one of those two things, make the virus better at infecting cells or make the virus less sensitive to the antibodies that the vaccine is inducing.
When you have multiple mutations in the virus, including three in this very sensitive area, does that make you think that it may not just be a neutral mutation?
Absolutely. Absolutely. It's two things that I wonder about. I wonder how the virus accumulated so many mutations. And then when you see a number of them together, that's probably telling you there's something different about that virus. Which ones are the ones that are driving the changes in the virus, and which ones may be neutral but just happen to be part of that fingerprint of this virus, is something that scientists are trying to figure out as soon as possible.
Now, when you look at the virus itself and where these mutations are, is it possible to tell biologically whether this virus is more capable of infection easier?
Yes, because we know we've already learned so much about this virus that we have some idea about some of the critical areas. And the one thing that jumps out as at us are these mutations in the spike protein. The three mutations in the spike protein have all been seen in other strains of SARS-CoV-2 that are circulating, but they've never been seen together in the same virus. So that's one sign. If you see mutations occurring separately, that means they may be important. When they all appear at the same time in the same virus, that's probably an addition to that.
Great. So what about thinking about where they appear on the spike protein?
So we know that one of the mutations, it's called 501, we know that one is in an area that is important for direct attachment of the virus to cells. So that's already been shown experimentally by a number of laboratories. So we know that that mutation will probably strengthen the virus's ability to bind to human cells. One of the other mutations appears in a site called a furin cleavage site. That's important for the virus to get into cells. And then another mutation is a deletion mutation, which also appears to make that protein better at entering cells. So when it comes to the spike protein, we already know that independently those three mutations can affect spike protein function and therefore are probably driving some changes in this virus.
So we've got a convergence of evidence here. You've got the epidemiological evidence that this virus seems to be transmitting more frequently than other variants. And you have the biological rationale for that, which is that these mutations in this variant are right on the most important protein for attaching to cells and appear in experiments to make it easier for the virus to get into cells.
Yeah, absolutely. And remember, that doesn't count the other 11 mutations that are here that we don't know much about in terms of what they're doing, but those could also be contributing. They may not be. That has to be experimentally determined because we don't have any data on those other mutations that the virus is carrying.
It's obviously a big deal that this variant is apparently more contagious. People are saying that it does not appear to be more lethal. Is that your understanding as well?
Yes, and all the data suggest exactly that. The people who have been infected with that show symptoms that are consistent with the symptoms of any other lineage of SARS-CoV-2. So these may be mutations that make the virus more transmissible, but not more lethal or more disease-causing. But we do have to remember that when a virus becomes more transmissible, that means that it could generate more cases, and then more cases, even with without a change in hospitalization rates or fatality rates, will mean more serious cases. So it's good that this virus isn't inducing more disease, but because it's spreading faster, it has the potential overall in a population to cause more severe cases. And again, that's another reason why we're concerned.
So from the perspective of the individual who's already sick, it may not make that much of a difference. But from the perspective of a community or a city, a state, a country, it could make it a lot worse.
Absolutely. And that's why so many countries are trying to focus to see if this variant is in their populations. And if it is, they're going to try to follow the spread of this virus much more carefully now.
Is there anything that can be done for this variant that's different than what you do for the usual threat of SARS-CoV-2?
Yeah. Well, it's important to note that it seems like even though those changes in S are making the virus more infectious, I've already seen preliminary data that suggests that the vaccine-induced immune responses still recognize this virus. So if you're scheduled to get a vaccine, stay online, get your vaccine. It should work against this virus strain. I think what's important to really pay attention to, though, is, you know, is this something now that is, let me rephrase that. Every time we have a new variant emerge, that means that there's a new combination of genes in this virus. And so we've now got to see if this version is more easily able to evolve and more easily able to handle other mutations in it. So it's a tricky question for scientists because we have to get this virus in the laboratory to study it to see how much other properties of the virus has changed outside of transmission.
Got it. So is it too early to say, like, wear a different kind of mask, do something differently than you would otherwise do? Or is it really about being really careful because there may well be a more transmissible virus in your area?
Yeah, right now, everything points to the fact that that masks, physical distancing, avoiding crowds, all those things should still be working against this variant. But we'll see how that pans out as we do more experiments in the laboratory.
Last question has to do with travel restrictions. You know, that this variant sort of burst into the news because Europe was putting travel restrictions on, some of which I think may have been changed a bit since then. The U.S. has considered some. Do you see a rationale for that based on this variant, or do you think the variant's likely already everywhere and it will be spreading at its own pace?
Yeah. The virus is here in the U.S. Travel restrictions aren't going to change anything in terms of its spread here in the U.S. The several cases that have already been identified, a couple of them have no travel history, and that suggests that they've picked up this new variant while they're here in the U.S. So I don't think travel restrictions are the way to go right now. It's sequencing more viruses and trying to find where this virus is and how well it's spreading that's going to be the really important thing.
Great. Well, we may check back in with you on this and other virus variants that come up. Thanks so much for taking time to talk with me.
My pleasure.
Public Health On Call is produced by Josh Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Stephanie Desmond. Audio production by Spencer Greer, Niall Owen McCusker, C.N. Oates, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Production support from Catherine Ricardo and Neiman Outlin. Social media support from Brenda Hageter, Grace Holes Fernandez, and Caroline Wong. Thank you for listening.